spring, but this week we will have two lectures in connection with a symposium on Coptic studies here at the Institute. The speaker tonight, Alexandros Tsakos, applied for this funding from the Norwegian Institute of Athens Foundation, and he received the award, so congratulations.
Thank you.
This is so we also have the Norwegian Institute of Athens stipend, but this is more prestigious, so I will just, that's why it was, yeah, congratulations are in order. And so he will speak tonight on the topic, as you see here, the Coptic manuscript, BL80, in the frame of medieval Libyan literacy. Before we start, I would just like to say it now, because I tend to forget things too fast. So so that I make sure I don't forget on afterwards, I would just also like to remind you all that on Thursday, the same time, 7:30, Professor Dimitris Moskos from Faculty of Theology here at Athens will, at the University of Athens, will present his lecture, Eschatological Motives in Egyptian Monasticism. So come back in 2 days, and then in the meantime, these scholars will have their discussions and papers here at the Institute. Dr. Tsakos is a postdoctoral fellow at the Department of Religious Studies at the University of Bergen in Norway, and he currently also teaches the introductory course in Coptic. The Coptic manuscript, BL80, about which Dr. Tsakos will talk tonight, is the most important source for the so-called Gospel of Bartholomew. This work was written for a recipient in Christianubia, and this is Dr. Tsakos' research. So, please.
Thank you very much, and thank you all for coming here today. Some of the announcements will be repeated in the talk as the rhetorics go. I'll try to follow my manuscript, because otherwise, when I speak about them, I tend to go all places and go out of time very easily. So, in fact, this is the second time that I'm giving a talk at the Norwegian Institute of Athens. The first time was in 2011 in the frame of the opening of a photo exhibition at the Islamic Museum of Benaki here in Athens. The exhibition was titled From Nubia to Sudan through the Eyes of the Greek-Norwegian Archaeological Mission, and we were invited to talk about the archaeological work we're conducting with my wife at the island of Sai. Henriette Hafsos-Tsakos and myself are researching the medieval period of the island with a focus on the last unexcavated cathedral of Christian Nubia. The project has been currently set on ice for family and logistic reasons, but we hope to return someday and complete the excavations. Today, however, we will only hear once more about Sai. The rest will be indeed about Nubia, the area that is traditionally identified with the Middle Nile region, roughly between Aswan and Khartoum, but this time through a different set of research material, namely manuscripts found at Nubian sites. I have in fact selected for you a set of sites with manuscripts of literary content, which will be of course the focus of this talk. This is the site of Sayala and the manuscripts in an unidentified Coptic hieroglyphic work. Kasreddin has given most of the manuscript finds. You see, you have your first encounter with an old Nubian manuscript with the Gospel of John. Jebel Adda is famous because it's at that site we found the last inscription mentioning a Christian Nubian king dated in 1484. The site of Castle Ruiz is a monastery having given more than 200 fragments of manuscripts in Coptic. The site of Pharos is mainly famous for its murals, but some manuscript fragments have also been found. We are preparing the publication with Professor Adam Waiter from Warsaw. The site of Sera East is a site excavated by the Institute of the Expedition and responsible for the publication of the textual finds. the publication is in print. Sunati is a small island surrounded by German missionaries as one Heidal campaigns in the 1960s. It has given some very interesting finds of old Nubian biblical passages. Atiri is a small site in the Bab el Hajar region, the Third Cataract, which has given a collection of old Nubian manuscripts. The book, the old Nubian text from Atiri, just came out 2 months ago. It's a collaboration of six colleagues, myself among them. Old Dongola is the capital of the kingdom of Makuria, the most renowned kingdom of medieval Nubia. Very, very few manuscripts have come from there. Mainly we know of two old Nubian texts, one of them I showed you here. And the most upstream site in Nubia which has produced manuscripts is a church on the island of Sur in the Fourth Cataract region, which is flooded by the Meroe Dam artificial lake, and 140 manuscripts were found. And this was the material for my PhD thesis. So the special focus today will be on those manuscripts that have preserved examples of such religious literature that I showed you now, taking as a starting point a codex from the British Library containing a Coptic work that is known under the title The Book of Resurrection of Jesus Christ by the Apostle Bartholomew. As most of you know, this text is the object of the seminar that I'm organizing these days. And I would just like to explain that Coptic is the last phase of the ancient Egyptian language. In other words, the one that was initially written in hieroglyphics, then in hieratic and demotic script, after the conquest of Egypt by Alexander the Great and the integration of the Roman Empire, Greek became a very important element in the language used in Egypt, in the script used in Egypt. So gradually the local language developed on the basis of the Greek script plus six characters taken from the demotic script. Coptic is a very important repository of texts of religious character, primarily Christian, and has provided sensational discoveries like the Nag Hammadi library, as well as controversies, as you perhaps have heard about the fraud of the Gospel of Jesus' wife recently. Most of this literature is written in Sahidi, which is the dialect used in Upper Egypt. Today, Coptic is, as people say, not used any longer in Egypt, but the Coptic Church is using a dialect called Bohairic, which is coming from Lower Egypt, for liturgical purposes. There are, of course, many other dialects known, but this would need a lecture of its own, so I will skip the details. Coptic has also been used by Christians in medieval Nubia, along with Greek and Old Nubian, and therefore both the manuscript from the British Library and its language fit perfectly in my postdoctoral project at the University of Bergen in Norway, titled Religious Literature of Christian Nubia. As the director of the institute said, in the frame of this project I also teach the introductory course in Coptic, which was introduced for the first time at the University of Bergen by Professor Reinhard Thomasen, who would have been with us but for family reasons he couldn't. And then it was taken up by Dr. Christian Boole, who is now a postdoctoral researcher at the University of Oslo with a current affiliation and staying at Princeton University. The three of us decided that it would be very nice if we could exchange opinions about the Coptic language and its use in the religious context with friends and colleagues working in Athens, beginning with Dr. Nikolaos Kouremenos, who is currently a postdoctoral fellow at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem, and Professor Dimitrios Moskos, who is teaching ecclesiastic history at the Theological School of Athens. Three of their students are with us, a PhD candidate, Elita Saradidi, and MA students, Michael Youssef and Vagelis Papanastasio. What we are doing these days is to read through this text from the manuscript photos, transcribe it, with the help of collation of two more witnesses with almost the same text about which I'm going to be speaking later in the talk, translate it and comment upon it. We hope to publish the result of this collaboration early next year. And the things that I will be talking about are therefore to be taken as a work in progress, so perhaps even some of the ideas might be improved by comments by my colleagues until Thursday. For the time being, we're enjoying ourselves very much, so once again, thank you. And what I would like to do, first of all, is to tell you that I'm not going to have any introduction about Christianity in general. Quite a lot of you have heard about it many times. Others might have read stuff that I have published, or other people have published, or can find it very easily online. There is even things that have been published in Greek online journals. What I'd rather do is to begin talking about the manuscript itself, and then from that expand into various topics concerning literacy, or sometimes more general cultural and contextualization issues that I will only touch upon, because there is already quite enough to be said about the manuscript itself. So, talking about the manuscript, perhaps one would expect that the text itself would be the point of departure. But this is not necessarily the case always, and it is definitely not going to be the case tonight. Because a manuscript is, first of all, an object, and this is where I'd like to begin from. The physical characteristics of Oriental 6804, or BL80, as it is called in the literature. This procedure has, in fact, nothing surprising by itself. More often than not, scholars present first the technical details relating to the text, and then proceed with its contents. In editorial practice of monumental epigraphy, for example, and I give you here a piece of a publication of mine about funerary inscriptions from the island of Sai, and that was the last time you were at Sai, it is a standard procedure to describe the find spot, its current whereabouts, the material the object is made of, its dimensions, particularities of decoration, and letter shapes. The first element of such a description, namely the find spot, is perhaps the most vulnerable data in the history of an inscribed object, especially on soft carriers like paper and parchment. Our manuscript is written on parchment, and it belongs to the bulk of the ancient and medieval manuscripts that have been preserved to our day, and which have not been found in controlled archaeological context, that is during archaeological excavation. But they were rather the objects of a purchase taking place between a foreigner on primarily Egyptian soil and a local trader who had received the manuscripts from either someone who made a chance find or from someone who systematically was robbing ancient and medieval sites. The degree of our knowledge of this history is in fact analogous to the degree of the profit made by each individual involved in this chain of trade. We know most about the foreigner who brought the objects to some museum or private collection, and it is this foreigner who profited most by selling abroad objects that in their land of origin might even have been sold for the price of a day's meal. Although I might be exaggerating on some details here, again, the profit of the finder can be accepted to be analogous to the degree of illegality of the finding process. The larger picture, I think, is accurate, and one wonders whether the reports by these individuals, which is probably all we need to know about the provenance of the manuscripts in question, can be trusted. This question has occupied a lot of papyrologists lately, but I will not tire you with more details about moral issues in conducting this type of research. If you wish, we can discuss matters later on. But especially in the case of BL80, this is how I will refer to the manuscript from now on, for not to use so many words. The way it arrived to England is worth a closer look, both because a provenance is claimed in the related reports, and because these reports are hindering our understanding of Nubian literacy, as I will try to explain shortly, or at least as shortly as possible. BL 80 belongs to the so-called Rustafjell manuscripts. Rustafjell was a British collector whose original name was Robert Focus Smith, although one suspects that even his name might be a fake. Robert became de Rustafjell in 1894, claiming to be a baron. After emigrating to the United States of America at the end of the First World War, he then claimed to be a Georgian prince, Roman Orbeliani. He also worked in Egypt as an engineer, and while there acquired a collection of Egyptian antiquities for himself, in addition to selling to others. Over a three-year period between 1907 and 1910, Rustafjell and other dealers sold manuscripts to the British Museum and the Freer Gallery that have traditionally been assigned to the monastery of St. Mercurius at Edfu, but made in Esna at the end of the 10th, the beginning of the 11th century. There are several manuscripts, however, which are outliers that have connections to other places in Egypt, including the Fayum or Nubia. The Nubian associated manuscripts of interest here are four. Apart from BL80, there are BL83 containing a Coptic work on the cross and two manuscripts with old Nubian texts, one again on the cross and one on St. Minas. Rustav had claimed that they all came from the same find in Edfu, but this was already being doubted by as important figures as Budge and Crumb. Despite early concerns about the authenticity of Rustafjell's claims, most scholars have persisted in believing the story, although Leighton cast doubt on that in his aforementioned catalogue. Recently, Bruce Williams from Chicago nailed the point down by pointing out that none of the Nubian manuscripts indicate in their colophon either Esna as the place of production or Edfu as the destination, which in the case of the manuscripts from Nubia would be an unnecessary intermediary stop on their way to the Nubian sites they were made for. And I repeat, this is knowledge that we do not gather by the reports of a possibly untrustworthy person, but that we can read ourselves in the colophons, that is, the concluding lines of pages of each manuscript written by the scribe and referring to his work's purpose. In other words, Bruce Williams gave to the Nubians agency in the production of some of the most important manuscripts that we can be sure that were either used in Nubia or destined to be used there. And this is more than fair enough, given the high degree of complexity of the medieval Nubian cultures. But in terms of reconstructing the provenance of these manuscripts, we might be left with legitimate doubts. How do we know that at some point or another the manuscripts did not return to Egypt and deposited, for example, in Edfu, where they were indeed found? And even more important, how do we know that the manuscripts were not made in Egypt and then sent to Nubia? An important argument against the latter hypothesis, which will concern us more tonight, is that two of the Nubian manuscripts in the Rustafjell lot were written in Old Nubian and were illustrated with images that resemble a lot the Nubian mural paintings, and thus there is no reason to be considered as imports. We know, however, of other manuscript collections written in a foreign language to the place of their finding, and in this case we know that the provenance is correct. I'm referring, for example, to the Glagolitic manuscripts found at Sinai, Glagolitic being a script rendering Old Slavonic. And let us keep in mind that BL80 is a manuscript in Sahidic Coptic, primarily the language of Egypt. In other words, even if Coptic was indeed used by Nubians in Nubia, the language of BL80 cannot be used as evidence of its provenance, as is the case with the manuscript in Old Nubian, at least not in favor of a Nubian provenance and against the provenance from Upper Egypt, where Sahidic was the main language of both written and oral communication. As far as Old Nubian illuminations, these are lacking from our manuscript, although by the end of the talk you will realize that also this can be readjusted a bit. A further problem that is raised by this discussion is the production of the carrier of the text itself. There is no indication in either the textual or the archaeological record that Nubians ever produced parchment. It seems rather that the traditional soft carrier produced in Nubia were tanned leather sheets. And I need to explain that the main difference between tanning leather sheets and creating parchment is that in order to create parchment, you need to apply gradually more tension on the parchment sheet. This is where BL80, our manuscript, comes into the discussion with important implications for understanding the complex situation of its place and conditions of production. In order to apprehend this, we will need to turn in more detail to the colophon of BL80, written on the verso, which means the backside, or folio, which means leaf in a codex, number 24, as one numbers the preserved pages from the codex. For the actual page numbers, you will hear in a while. So despite the fragmentary state of the this was the colophon, and now I'm saying that despite the fragmentary state of the first lines of the colophon, the text can be easily reconstructed because it contains a formulaic invocation to the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, as well as to to the Holy and Consubstantial Trinity. The reconstruction was achieved in 1924 by Van Lanschot in the first volume of a collection of the colophons of the Christian manuscript in Egypt, dedicated to the Sahidic manuscripts. From the collection by Van Lanschot, we can make some interesting quantitative observations. The invocation to the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit is used in colophons only from Upper Egypt and Nubia. There is only one of those that contains the reference to the consubstantial Trinity, and the manuscript belongs to the zone of spiritual influence of Abba Shenoute, the most prolific writer in Sahidic Coptic and the abbot of the White Monastery at Sohag in Upper Egypt. Thus, the invocation of the colophon situates indeed the scribal production in the Upper Egyptian Nubian milieus. What situated BLA more particularly in Nubia is a reference to the dedication of the codex to a church built at a place called Ilelarti. The site cannot be identified, and scholars interested in the question have not reached an agreement as to how the toponym should be interpreted. The only agreement concerns the last part of the word, namely Arti, which is a non-Nubian word for island. Thus, the Nubian link in our survey. Recently, an interesting interpretation of the morph Ilel has been suggested, and I need to explain that if I read this Yota, Lambda, Lambda with a supralinear stroke as Ilel, is because the supralinear stroke hides inside a phoneme which would be a sound, a short sound E or E. Anyway, this interpretation was brought forward by Westerhoff, who published in 1999 the most updated edition of BL 80. We will repeatedly return to the publication, this publication during the talk. Westerhoff suggested to read Ilel like a variant Eile in Old Nubian, which means grain. There are three linguistic obstacles with accepting full-heartedly this interpretation, and I will present them in ascending degree of gravity. First, in Ilarti, the supralinear stroke is above the second lambda, while in Eile, above the first. Fluctuations in these practices are very common, though. But second, the word in our manuscript begins with a yota, and not an epsilon yota. Although this yotacism is not a rare phenomenon at all, there would be no word starting with a single yota in Old Nubian. Moreover, a fall of epsilon and its replacement with a yota retrieved from the vocal hidden behind the supralinear stroke would render the use of the supralinear stroke redundant. Third, the final epsilon of a le would never be assimilated in Old Nubian with the following alpha, but would rather be followed by a ni to indicate genitive of grain, the island of grain. There is another important issue, but of different order, with the grain island of Westerhof, namely that the toponym is not attested elsewhere. Since the word sounds like a very possible place name, this again is really problematic only if one can come up with an alternative suggestion for the toponym. And already Lanschot had alluded to a very plausible alternative that I wish to share with you tonight. Let's have a closer look at this word in the manuscript. The yota with the diéresis can very easily be the product of a mistaken copy from an original where it was written as with a tau, a taf. How does that help? By the fact that the word telel means God in Old Nubian, and the toponym telel arti is attested twice in the Old Nubian corpus. Once in an inscription from Old Dongola and once in a manuscript from Castle Brim. Although we can still not locate with any certainty the exact place behind the place name, Adam Wader has suggested that it might be in the vicinity of Dongola because of the funerary stele found there, but the find from Castle Brim was not known to him, so things again change. I think nevertheless that the toponym makes more sense as the island of God. But wait a second. How could the scribe have made such a mistake? Especially if he were a Nubian, as it can be conjectured from his wish to dedicate his work to the church on a Nubian island, this would make little sense, right? Unless the scribe was not a Nubian, and the manuscript was ordered by Nubians to a scriptorium abroad from where they used to import literary works. In a hypothetical but plausible, because known from other instances, correspondence ordering the word telelarti would have been written and the scribe copied it wrongly. Actually, what is important to note is in either interpretation of Island of Grain or Island of God, our scribe doesn't feel that much at home with Nubia. There is in fact a further detail in the colophon that would corroborate the idea that the scribe was rather active in Egypt than in Nubia. This is the use of the term aperaton to describe the donation of the manuscript to the church on Arti. Layton suggested that this term is the same as the term waqf, makufi, namely a pious donation that as soon as it reached its destination should not be any longer removed. Let me note that the word aperaton does not appear in any published Nubian texts, and that in Van Lanschot's catalogue it is used again only in a colophon of a manuscript from Upper Egypt. So, if our scribe was a Nubian and active in Nubia, why would he refer to the legal system prevalent in Islamic Egypt? There are two more elements of comparison that should be brought into the discussion because they enhance our understanding of what was the situation with the production of texts in Upper Egypt and Nubia. The first is the issue of parchment that opened this investigation of the colophon. In line 10, the scribe tells us that he wrote these things on membrana, that is, parchment leaves, that he made himself. Bruce Williams considers this as hard evidence for rejecting the prevalent today idea that Nubians did not produce parchment themselves, but were importing it from Egypt. First, if we have satisfactorily situated BL 80 in an Egyptian scriptorium, Bruce's argument loses its strength. Moreover, this is the only colophon from Van Lanschot's catalogue where such a claim is made by the scribe. And this is understandable, because as Roger Bagnall, among others, has shown, the production of parchment was a very onerous procedure that involved the slaughtering of several animals. So if our scribe was indeed the maker of these parchment leaves, he went to great extents to finance his project. Nevertheless, he remains unnamed, which is not usually in colophons of old Nubian manuscripts, but in the cases that it does happen, might be explained by the humbleness of the donors, scribes, copyists, binders, and other persons involved in the production of a codex. There is another plausible explanation, though. As we can see, the text of the colophon is not completed when the parchment leaf ends. It is therefore very probable that it continued in a new leaf, let's say the 25th of the preserved codex. In that now lost text, the scribe might have been naming himself, continuing the prayer, introducing other individuals, dating his work. All these things are impossible to ascertain, but there is further proof that the codex had more pages. We should now turn to codicology. Codicology is the study of the form of the codex, the way the leaves are bound together to form this original text carrier that we now call a book. The standard procedure was by folding large parchment sheets and then putting several such sheets together, creating what is called a quire. Then these quires would be bound together, forming the codex. According to what is known as the Robert rule, wherever the parchment book is opened, flesh side faces flesh side, and hair side faces hair side. I explain here that when you prepare a leather sheet, still you can see on one side the surface for the hair and on the other side the surface for the meat. Despite the inlaying of the individual folia in the British Museum codex with paper, still we can see the difference between hair side and flesh side. Thus, Layton could calculate the plausible codicological combinations of the preserved folia and come them up with the following reconstruction of the quires of BL 80, and I hope that now I'm not going to lose you. So, the first quire, had a sequence of hair, flesh, flesh, hair in the first half of the choir, and then flesh, hair, hair, flesh. As you see, I'm only naming the rectos, the front pages of its sheet. This means that the choir consisted of five sheets folded in two and bound together, with the first folio having the hair side facing outwards. The choir followed the Robert rule to the exception of the third folio, where flesh and flesh are not meeting and hair is not meeting, but flesh meets hair and vice versa. The second choir had the sequence hair, flesh, flesh for the first half of the choir, and hair, flesh for the second half of the choir, which disrupted the Robert rule at the central folio. And there was a third choir for which Westerhoff amended Leto's impossible suggestion of flesh, 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 hair with remaining folia missing. Flesh, 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 hair with remaining folia missing, by adding the only possible reconstruction for this missing folia, namely hair, hair. Thence, I can now suggest that the first page of these two last and reconstructed codicological folia contained the remainder of the colophon, where we could expect to find the previously mentioned information lacking from a more standard colophon. Then, the last leaf, so which means both flesh and her side, would be left empty in guise of a cover. And the remaining page, the verso of the second last folio, perhaps contained a full page illumination, as it was the case at least with one more manuscript from the Rustafia list that you already saw, the one containing the Minas Miracle in Old Lubia. But there is more. What we also know is that the codex is not complete because folio 1b, so the verso of the first preserved folio of what remains of the codex, has the original pagination number 12. So the rest of the parchment is not preserved, but we have legible page numbers, as you can see on top. That's number 12, and that's number 56, that show us, excuse me, I have marked with blue color the pages that are still visible on the manuscript as it's preserved today, and the rest is a reconstruction based precisely on those, and the only possible codicological reconstruction on the base of the combinations of hair and flesh sides of the manuscript as achieved by Leighton and Westerhoff. The result was a very beautiful one of choirs of three, five, five, and three leaves each, explaining also in codicological terms the pride felt by our scribe. But in Nubia, there has never been found a choir exceeding three folded leaves, and therefore it is perhaps legitimate to suggest that the final product that became BL80 was prepared outside Nubia. Of course, the argument cannot stand on its own, but in combination with the other evidence, it might be useful to hold. In any case, the final product was not an alien object for the Nubians, since they received it as a religious donation. That BL80 could feel at home in Nubia is also supported by paleographical evidence. And I have to explain that when we speak about paleography, we should understand the study of letter shapes with the goal to establish scriptorial provenance and possible datings. The reason is that another manuscript from Nubia, this time discovered at the Nubian site in the frame of an archaeological dig, provides the closest paleographic parallel to BL80. This manuscript is the famous Wies Codex, discovered in the 1970s at the Nubian monastery of Castel Wies. Either we look at the overall layout of the page in one column, and the decoration, Here, for example, you can see the remains of the legs of a bird, like the one decorating the margins on the much better preserved Greek codex, or the details of individual letter shapes, even the decoration of the lobes of the letter phi, or the system of superalineation with longer strokes for syllables inside the word and smaller strokes for initial letters, which just hide these little phonemes I was explaining behind. The similarities are striking. The handwriting seems to belong to the so-called Nubian manuscripts type. This paleographic type dominates Nubian literacy from circa the 9th century onwards, based on quite securely dated gravestones from Nubia. Also, this script was in use in Egypt, and a recent article by Anne Boudor has attempted to trace the history of what can be called in Coptic paleography as inclined majuscule, as contrasted to the upright one. This ancien penché seems to be used in Egypt originally for specific parts of manuscripts like the incipits and the colophons, or for specific types of texts like those used in the liturgy, and only in the 12th century being generalized irrespective of the content of the manuscript. Interestingly, although there are some earlier literary manuscripts with an inclined majuscule, Boudor cannot propose a place of provenance for this paleographic tradition. I have proposed in several occasions, though, that this tradition was the result of vivid exchanges between Upper Egypt and Nubia that should be seen not as two different worlds divided by insurmountable borders, but as a common territory where scriptural and spiritual traditions were exchanged freely and creatively. An interesting parallel to the situation, would be the British Library manuscript Oriental 6799, where the scribe Mercury, son of Pameos, sent a manuscript with Cyril of Jerusalem's Sermon on the Cross to be deposited at the Church of the Cross at Sera East. Mercury of Pameos claims in the same colophon that most probably the donor was the son of someone called Mashenka from Pharos, and Mashenka is a clearly and well-attested Nubian name. Such exchanges are paradigmatic of the links between Upper Egypt and Nubia. And interestingly, a recent study by Tasha Vorderstrasse from Chicago recognized in who studied the illumination in codices that are linked with Nubia, recognized in this manuscript the least Nubian and the most Egyptian-like decoration among all these codices that we're discussing tonight. Anyway, this is how I understand the social life of the manuscript BL80. It was produced at an Upper Egyptian scriptorium to be deposited in a church in Nubia. From there, it was wrote by someone, perhaps in the early 20th century, and it ended up through an Egyptian dealer with a lot bought by Rustafel, who assigned it to the Esna Edfu lot to increase its price. It might have been a sinuous track of thoughts, but at least we have now a plausible background to the history of the object that became BL80. But why all this fuss? What does this text contain, and what is its particular interest? We have now come to the presentation of the text itself, as is the normal editorial procedure. I will not present here the transcription, translation, critical apparatus, and hermeneutical commentary, which would take hours. I will only brief you about the manuscripts preserving the same text, which help reconstruct the original contents, summarize these contents, identify the genre of the work, and contextualize it in the frame of religious literacy in Christian Nubia. So, apart from BL80, two more witnesses have been identified, both assigned to the White Monastery Library. The three witnesses have been named A, B, and C, with BL80 being manuscript C. Very recently, Alan Sutsiu identified the long-lost fragment that preserved the incipit of manuscript A, and I will return to this very important discovery. The importance of these witnesses, as has been shown by the work of Westerhoff, is that they help us reconstruct the text of BL80 where they overlap. Interestingly, manuscripts A and B do not contain the end of the work as this appears in manuscript C, but they preserve for us parts of the beginning of the work, which is lost from manuscript C, as we saw in the codicological reconstruction presented earlier. The preserved parts from the beginning of the work start off at the Last Supper, continue with the betrayal of Judas, and then pass at the crucifixion. The central figure there is someone called Ananias, who embraces the body of Jesus and is offered salvation, but nevertheless passes through martyrdom. When manuscript C begins, we see the ascension to the heavens of Ananias and the burial of Jesus by Joseph of Arimathea. Then the scenery changes completely. We see death coming to hell to find out where is the soul of this person that died but has not appeared there yet. We follow death trying to locate Jesus in company of his six sons, find him at his tomb, then follows a long dialogue between the two until Jesus departs for the underworld, from where he returns not only with Adam and Eve, but with the souls of all the dead except for Judas, Herod, and Cain. The complete victory over death is signified by death's recognition that the soul that ruined him and destroyed hell is the Son of God. This victory of Jesus is what is known in literature as the harrowing of hell, a scene that is missing from the canonical Gospels and has been traditionally linked with the so-called Acts of Pilate. The harrowing of hell has in fact become the traditional iconographic pattern that represents the resurrection of Christ, a scene that is falsely termed the Anastasis. In Nubia, the scene appears twice, once from the Cathedral of Pharos and once from the church at Banganati. Since the Acts of Pilate have not been found in Nubia, it is worth examining whether this iconographic pattern is in fact inspired in Nubia by the Book of Bartholomew. The richness of the archaeological discoveries from Sudan may enrich this picture from both the textual and the iconographic perspective. After the harrowing of hell, our manuscript sets the scene outside the tomb where the holy women have arrived to mourn Jesus. The tomb is in the garden of someone called Philogenes, and after an initial encounter with him that is full of dramatic implications that I do not have the time to analyze here, Jesus appears to the women. What follows is a dialogue between Jesus and his mother, who is given the responsibility of conveying the message of the resurrection to the apostles. Bartholomew also appears in the scene and witnesses the praise of Mary by Jesus. Then Mary brings the good news to the apostles, whereupon we follow the revelation of an ascension of Jesus to the heavens that was offered to Bartholomew. Bartholomew himself presents his revelation as a book that he has written that should not be disclosed to the wrong persons, a tradition very much in accordance with saying in other apocryphal works. And that's the text saying that the copy. Moreover, he places the revelation on the 15th of the month of Parmute, which is between April and May, taking the Easter, which is quite surprising because there is reference to the Pentecost, and very important for the liturgical contextualization of the word, as you will see by the end of this talk. Next in our text appears God the Father, who invites Jesus to sit on his right side and the angels to praise him. Eight hymns were supposed to follow, but the enumeration is mixed up, and I'm looking forward to seeing how we will tackle this tomorrow or after tomorrow when we read the specific section. More hymns by Adam and the just conclude this lyric pivotal point of the whole work. They all depart to the seventh heaven, and the scene returns to the congregation of the apostles. Bartholomew shows great humility and is praised by the others. Another scene of ascension follows, and then God the Father blesses each apostle individually. They proceed with an incense offering that reaches God the Father, who invites his Son to console his disciples. So the first appearance of Jesus to the apostles follows, full of sentiment and concluding with a chrisma that they receive from the blood of the crucified and resurrected Son of God. By now, the focal human person is Peter, leader among the apostles, in guise of archbishop among the bishops, and the only witness we have for the rest of the story is exclusively manuscript C, that is, BL 80. Then, the focus turned to Thomas. As we know well from the canonical Gospels, he was not present during the first apparition of Jesus. Our apocryphal book says that he received the message that his son, Theophanes, had died. He goes to the city of Jerusalem, finds the tomb of his son, and resurrects him. Then Theophanes narrates to his father his post-mortem experience, dominated by a vision of the 12 thrones of the apostles, he returns to the house he was staying and repeats the narrative, while Thomas baptizes 12,000 persons, sends the foundation of a church, and returns to the other apostles. A much more effective visit to Jerusalem than yours, Nikos, I would say. The scene of doubting ensues, when Jesus appears again and, after a long dialogue with Thomas, gives him also the chrisma with the blood. Before departing, he reminds Peter of his tasks, and the work concludes with a Eucharist shared among the apostles. Since the scene of his humility, Bartholomew appears only once to exhort Thomas against doubting. It seems that the author felt that the book of Bartholomew had lost its focus, and before ending, reminds his reader this, also by stating, right before the final scene with the Eucharist, the title of the work. We are in folio 23 versos, so just one page before the end of the whole story, where we read the book of the resurrection of Jesus the Christ. In fact, the title appears again in the colophon, but this time we need to reconstruct it from this previous mention, because in line 5 we only read the book of the resurrection. These two instances are the only ones that the title appear in the manuscript witnesses that were collated by Vestal. So Vestal, this means both A, B, and C only contain these two references. However, these references cannot be considered as the title of the work, technically speaking, which normally should appear either in the beginning or in the end of the entire work. So either before everything starts or after the colophon. It is time to return to the recent discovery by Alexandros. He identified among the collections of Cornell University another witness of the Book of the Resurrection, long thought lost. In this fragment, the identification of the title was guaranteed, since the fragment belonged originally, as I said earlier, to the incipit of manuscript A from the White Monastery. But a surprise was awaiting us. The mention of the resurrection was nowhere to be seen. Thus, Tsutsiu correctly suggested that the work should from now on be termed the Book of Bartholomew. Again, one wonders whether the appearance of the name Anastasis and Resurrection twice in BL 80 was there to excuse the long diversion with Thomas and Theophanes. Interestingly, the other two witnesses of the work do not contain any traces of the narrative about Theophanes. Was this added only in the witness of the Book of Bartholomew as seen in BL 80? The question should remain open. But the compilation, especially for the Nubian context for which the manuscript was destined, is an attractive suggestion, I think. The fragment from Cornell offers more evidence supporting this idea. The narration of the revelation by Bartholomew to the other apostles was placed specifically, that's the title, I should have shown that earlier, I'm sorry, was placed specifically in time, namely the 17th of the month Parmuter. This placement identifies clearly the work as the reading used on that specific date in the Coptic Church, which I remind you was nevertheless read in the Church of Medieval Nubia on the 15th of the month of Parmuter. Evidence for the existence of a Nubian synaxarion multiplied as our research advances with both the textual and the iconographic record from Nubia, but again, I have spoken about this topic in many other instances, but I think it is time to wrap up my talk for tonight. So, this liturgical character of our manuscript witnesses was nuanced by Tsutsiu in the following manner. By analyzing the phraseology of the textual witnesses for the Book of Bartholomew, like the expression, my members, that Jesus uses to address the apostles, by scrutinizing the apocalyptic imagery of the ascension with the enormous body of Christ reaching the heavens while his feet still stand on earth, as well as by underlining the similarity of certain ideas, like the existence of a book with hidden, that is, apocryphal knowledge, or the primordial role of Peter in part of the narrative of the Book of Bartholomew, Tsutsiu, and I quote his concluding phrase, brought home this text, namely the memoir of Bartholomew the Apostle, who saw the angels singing at the resurrection. End of quote. It is precisely this term memoir, which is the genre that the Book of Bartholomew belongs to. A genre that suits you terms apostolic or pseudo-apostolic memoirs, and which were used in the liturgy until the turn from the first to the second millennium CE, despite a certain polemic that existed in the Coptic Church concerning the use of Apocrypha. He moreover identifies two groups of such memoirs, those included inside the patristic homily and those without a homiletic framework. Although works from Nubia belong to both categories, three of the six entries in the latter category are works identified in Nubia, including the Book of Bartholomew and the larger of the two works from the Wiz Codex. I should note that the latter work exists in both a Coptic and an Old Nubian version, and that the third memoir, namely the Book of the Investiture of the Archangel Michael, is among the most popular liturgical readings for the Nubians, according to the manuscript witnesses that have come to us, which include versions of the original Coptic text in Old Nubian and in Greek, as well as at least one variant in Nubian Greek. Tsutsiu makes a last point. He suggests that these works were the products of monastic milieus. Indeed, some of the witnesses from Nubia come from the monastery of Castre Wiz. But their discoveries in secular settlement sites like Castle Brim and Serra East beg the question whether these manuscripts arrived to their new home from monasteries in Upper Egypt, as might have been suggested by our scrutinizing of manuscript BL80. To certify such links, more thorough analysis of contents and ideas should be made, like the study of eschatological motifs in Egyptian monastic literature, the title of the lecture by Professor Moskos on Thursday. So while we start active reading our texts of the Book of Bartholomew tomorrow and after tomorrow, you should stay tuned and try to come back and hear more of this exciting material, a sense that I hope I conveyed to you tonight. So thank you for your attention.